You know the drill. You're making out. You start feeling your way downtown. One of you wants to make a move to Cunnilingusville, but you don't have protection. Dental dams are hard to use, hard to come by, and condoms taste like, well, condoms. Hundreds of millions of people worldwide have STIs that can be transmitted via oral sex. So let me introduce you to Laurels, a first-of-its-kind product that provides protection, sexy style, and comfort. And it tastes like vanilla. Laurels for protection are FDA approved for STI protection during oral-based activities. And Laurels for pleasure are the perfect cross between sexy lingerie and kinky toys. These thin and incredibly stretchy single-use silky latex undies are worn during fingering, rimming, oral sex, tribbing, and more. Head over to mylaurels.com to get your 4-pack today. Be sure to use my code for a discount at checkout. What's Your Position Podcast? All one word. And remember, stay safe, stay kind, and stay sexy with Laurels.
What's Your Position Podcast may contain adult themes, sexual discussions, and strong language. We want everyone to be educated, but we are intended for mature audiences. Listener discretion is advised. Live from WIP Studios in Huntington Beach, California, this is What's Your Position. On today's show, Ashley talks to adult film actress Jessica Drake. Porn has gone mainstream. It's like Coke or Pepsi with dicks in it. Look at Paris Hilton. She throat fucks a guy in night vision. Now she's selling fragrances to teens. And now your host, Ashley Weller.
Welcome, fellow humans, porn lovers.
Sorry, that was a little spicy, everybody.
It's spicy.
She loves to be spicy.
Good episode for the spice. Interesting intro. Paris Hilton throat fucking a guy and then selling fragrances to children. What is that from?
Give me a guess.
Something that references Paris Hilton, so it has to understand that it is in its own universe. I'm just going to go with an old standard of yours and say Always Sunny.
No. You know, good guess.
Thank you.
Zach and Miriam Make a Porno.
Damn it! Oh, I was going to go with a movie, too, but I couldn't figure out which movie I would go to. Welcome. Welcome, all humans. Today's episode is going to be a two-parter. It's our first two-part episode, producer. Pretty excited about it. We got the rare and really unique opportunity to speak with adult film star, or as she puts it, mattress actress. That is her favorite phrase to call herself, is a mattress actress. She's like, I don't care. Call me a porn star. Call me an adult film star. Call me an actress. Call me whatever. I'm a mattress actress. And I was like, that's actually brilliant.
Pretty clever.
I like that.
She come up with that?
She did. So now that's on her bio when she does PowerPoints. I was honored when she came to my class, my human sexuality class, to give a talk to all the students, and then said, yeah, I would absolutely love to be on your podcast. And months went by and I messaged and she didn't message me back. And I was like, I don't want to be that person. Like, I really don't want to be that annoying little fly that's like, come to my podcast because you're famous and hot.
Gotta have to.
I know. So finally, I was like, okay, she's coming back for my fall human sexuality class. I'm going to pitch it to her like, you're already down here. I'll buy you dinner. We can get a drink and we can do a quick podcast episode. She was like, absolutely no problem. And then leading up to it, I was like, is she going to bail? And she didn't. She messaged me and was like, I'm so excited to do your podcast. What do you want to talk about? And I was like, you and how awesome you are. She came. She did my class.
She came?
She did. Twice. She came to the class and then she came to the bar.
There you go.
And I did some research too. I did a little bit of research on her.
You, wait, hold on. You did research?
Get out of here.
I did.
Get out of here.
I did my normal research. So I do happen to know a couple of things. Porn brings in $97 billion annually in the United States. Or excuse me, globally. In the United States, $12 billion annually. That's a lot of fucking money. That's a lot of money. Oh, the air show is this weekend. One of those jet fighters, one of those like F-18s, costs $1 billion. So 12 of those jet fighters are how much it would cost to pay for the amount of porn that is consumed in this country on a yearly basis.
Yeah, that's a lot of fucking.
It's a lot of fucking. Porn and adult film sites, including sites like OnlyFans, pull in more viewers than Netflix, Amazon, and YouTube.
Don't say combined.
Combined.
Gah.
Can you believe that?
I can't believe
I can
that.
Too. But like, wow. We're consuming porn. I get it. It's great. Especially during COVID when you didn't have much else to do. OnlyFans was born out of necessity. As we get into speaking to Miss Drake, she's on OnlyFans. I actually wasn't sure going into it if she was and like how she felt about it. But it comes up because what we discuss is ethical porn. Have you heard of this?
Have you heard of this? Have you heard of this? Yeah, you brought that up.
I did.
Yeah, you brought this up.
And she is a champion for a lot of different things, actually. She's a champion for a homeless movement where she goes and feeds homeless individuals and provides them with toiletries and things like that, which is the sponsor that we're going to bring up, or the nonprofit, charity. The charity we're going to bring up. She also has a line of lubrication called Wicked Sensual Essentials. It's on her website, JessicaDrake.com. You can also go to Wicked Guide to Wicked Sex, and Jessica Drake has that website as well, where she does porn educationally. So it's like watching your favorite porn star give a blowjob and then explain how she's giving the blowjob so that people can learn how to have sex from their favorite porn actress or from someone who's been doing it and kind of knows what she's doing.
Is it for for household porn, like sex, or because my mind went to like the schools that teach you how to do WWF wrestling.
No, she okay. No, it's for the individual. Okay. Like it's for she has one
nice
on
things up.
She has one on masturbation. Okay. She has one on anal
I'm
sex.
Pretty professional and I mean, I'll listen to her.
Guys maybe a little more professional gotcha. With their masturbation techniques, but for women it might be a little more difficult. She also does one on mutual masturbation. She also does one on female oral sex, so she teaches someone how to give her oral sex and then the audience learns as well. And you can buy these videos. This is Jessica Drake's Guide to Wicked Sex. She is also a champion for ethical porn, which means that she isn't telling people like, hey, I hate Pornhub, I hate YouPorn, I hate XXNX. I don't hate those sites. I understand what they're there for, and the internet took over porn. There's not a lot we can do about it. But follow your favorite porn stars on Instagram and then go see where they're doing their work, making sure that, because she made a really great point. She may film a scene and it's titled Jessica Drake Fucks Handyman, okay, but Pornhub may change the, whoever uploads it to Pornhub could change the title to say Jessica Drake Fucks Her Brother, and Jessica Drake doesn't do faucest, doesn't do incest, and so she's like, that's being put out there into the universe as something that I didn't do. That's not right. What I stand for, but there's nothing I can do about it. I know the industry I work in. I know what I set myself up for. So
it's like if a musician writes a song and then like a DJ remixes it and he doesn't like the remix or the DJ, it's like, well, as long as he pays for the rights, I guess. Oh,
but
I guess important.
They're not
happen.
Paying. Yeah, that's
sometimes
the
that doesn't happen either in music, though.
Yeah. So it's like they're not getting paid for whatever someone uploads on to Pornhub. So she's just a champion for making sure that people. Her main concern with ethical porn is that everyone is of age and everyone is consenting to what's going on. We get into her contract with Wicked, which is one of the largest porn companies in the world. We discuss her favorite scenes that she's ever filmed.
that I actually was really afraid to ask her that question. And when I asked it, she answered in a heartbeat. She said, I have two. I was like, oh, do you need a minute to think? She's like, no, I have two. Great. Perfect. Jessica Drake is just a very incredible human being. She does a lot of charity work. She does a lot of work with education. She's really into educating individuals about their bodies and consent and sex ed and what porn is and what porn isn't. And I was just super grateful to have her in my presence, even just for that 3 hours, just that small window of time.
That's the reason it's two-parter.
Why it's two parts, because I interviewed her. I swear I was trying to be so mindful of how long the episodes were. And I was like, okay, it's been like 30 minutes. And then I would look down and it had been like an hour and a half. I was like, fuck.
Time flies when you're doing a podcast.
Right? And she was just so easy to talk to. And
great. Yeah. I haven't listened to it yet. I mean, audience. I mean,
yeah.
Full disclosure.
I haven't listened to the whole thing either. But before we...
I'm excited to hear it.
I'm very excited. I'm very aroused. Before we get into the episode, I wanted to give you a quick tip.
Tip or stat?
A tip.
Okay.
Of the day.
Tip of the day.
It's like a Tibetan singing bowl. You gotta follow it all the way out. Beautiful. Thing of beauty. Ethical porn, otherwise known as fair trade porn, is sex-positive pornography that centers around conscious business practices, meaning the actors are being paid fair wages, all pleasure is consensual, working conditions are safe. So there's a lot of times when people just upload gonzo porn and they're having sex in the back of a van. That's not safe. Where's your seatbelt? Where's your seatbelt? It shows diverse bodies, all body types, all genders, all sexual orientations. It's not seen through a heteronormative male gaze. It's sex for everyone, basically, is what ethical porn is. It isn't heteronormative, meaning it isn't just about a guy pounding a girl or lesbian sex for the sake of lesbian sex. It's actually that everyone there is happy about what they're doing. I love porn. I think porn is great. I think it's an amazing tool to help individuals feel seen, help feel represented. I think it's a great way to expand your sexual horizons, to kind of figure out if you want to try new things. I think it can be a great way to get to know your body and the bodies of other people. But I do think that it can be harmful when viewed for the wrong reasons. And if you're viewing porn because you want to watch a girl get choked until she passes out, that's probably not a healthy type of porn that you're watching. But if you really enjoy a girl getting her nipples sucked until she comes, great. Fuck yeah. Continue watching that shit. Ethical porn might be a little difficult to find because you don't necessarily know if the free porn that you're viewing was done in an ethical manner, because usually the holding up of the IDs so that everyone knows that everyone's of age gets cut out. And only the good stuff gets put up. The foreplay leading up to the cum shot gets cut out because nobody wants to watch the foreplay when they're on a free website. Did you know how long the average amount of time spent on a porn website is?
The average.
The average.
I'm going to go six. No, well, one, 6 minutes. And nine. That'd be 7 minutes and 30 seconds. Or 7 minutes. Yeah, 7 minutes and 30 seconds. Yeah. That's 69
seconds.
Yeah.
Stupid.
69 minute or whatever. Yeah.
It's 18 minutes.
Oh, really?
Yeah. From start to finish, because you got to find the one you want, right? So you log on, you go through.
I don't think my average is that big.
But the average porn isn't 18 minutes long, right? It's usually an hour. Like, they got to do the
Not the free ones.
Not the free ones, yeah. But like they're cutting those down is what I'm saying.
Right.
Like they're taking the long, like
the good stuff.
They're getting, but some of the other stuff is good stuff.
Now, like there are specific ones where you could, if you doing the highlights, it'll tell you, okay, here comes the blowjob. This is reverse cowgirl. Here comes, this is doggy, and here's the cum shot.
You can see the, like on YouTube, like the most viewed moments in that
point. Yeah, that's weird too. I don't want to know that.
But I did some other research prior to interviewing Jessica Drake, and I watched three of her porns, full length.
I bet husband Weller did too.
He probably did. I don't know. I did this research on my own, but he probably did. And there is some pieces of it where you're like, oh, no wonder they don't put this on Pornhub. Like in the beginning, all the girls are in their outfits and they're all just kind of wriggling and writhing and sort of showing off their sexy bits and making faces at the camera and just kind of being objects of the camera's attention for a while. And that goes on for like 5-6 minutes. And then they kind of start moving with each other and touching each other and then kind of start making out. And that takes about 5 to 6 minutes. And then there's like 10 minutes of making out and 10 minutes of like groping. And then there's like 10 more minutes of like a little bit of play. It's like takes 45 minutes to
Let's
get
go, ladies. Come
to
on.
Anybody. But also in actual sex, it sometimes takes people a little bit longer to, you can't just shove it in and go. That's where porn starts to become frustrating for sex educators, because what you think of sex is this girl's ready, I'm going to stick it in and I'm going to come right away. It's like, wait a minute, what do you think led up to that?
On the other side, the guy's always ready.
Always hard. We had a girl raise her hand and they were like, what did porn teach you? And she's like, that men are always hard. That's what porn teaches us. Like, that a guy has to just be constantly hard and ready for sex.
Or, I mean, there are guys out there.
There are.
But not the majority.
No. But it was just interesting because I watched this and I was like, wow, no wonder they chop up porn and put them in little pieces on this website. But it doesn't really do the porn stars that put in the time and the hours justice.
Think about what TikTok is. These little segments.
The attention span of our human beings. So my tip of the day is where you can find some ethical porn. Jessica has some interesting ideas. She gives some shout outs to some ethical porn sites that she likes. Fosta Sesta is one of them. Also, OnlyFans, she says, is a great place to go. And then she suggests following your favorite porn star on Instagram and seeing if they have an OnlyFans and seeing if they have content that you can pay for. Reddit, that's a good one. Another one is Bellessa, Four Chambers, Aorta Films, X Confessions, Kink, Bright Desire, and I Feel Myself. And Jessica and I actually talk about a couple of these websites, and she gives her opinion on whether or not she thinks that they are the best ethical porn sites and whether or not she enjoys them as much as the internet does. But yeah, it was a really, really fucking interesting conversation. And the fact that it is 3 hours long and felt like 20 minutes says something about how awesome.
Do you know how OnlyFans started?
I don't. Do you?
Yeah.
Was it Reddit?
It was basically going to be the rival to Patreon.
Mm.
And you can still do that on OnlyFans. It's just porn took over. I think Patreon doesn't allow that. And so OnlyFans found this niche of like, well, if you're not going to do it, we'll do it. We'll just do it. It's going to be harder. Like, there's a lot more, I think, things they had to do with like lawyers and stuff. And, you know, keeping it 18, but that's what I know about it.
So there was actually OnlyFans in the 90s. It was called babesforyou.com, and it grossed over $60,000 per month. Was like the first OnlyFans, Babes right. for You, pay for porn website, where the girls were their own bosses and right. like had their own content.
Yeah.
So this isn't something new. And then, but OnlyFans has just changed the landscape.
Capitalism, man.
Man, it's great.
Just did it better.
And all of Jessica, she says that all of her friends are like, that's it. That's the way to go, especially during COVID. She had a lot of time where she was just taking requests, basically like a DJ.
Yeah. I just see this just as like SoundCloud.
Mm-hmm. And now she says, she actually drops a huge bomb in this episode. I asked her a question that I was really interested. I was gonna ask her, when you filmed your last porn scene, did you know it was your last?
Oh, she's like officially retired. Oh,
so
wait, okay.
We discuss her contract with Wicked, and then we discuss her OnlyFans and how it's just her, and it's not like her with other people.
Gotcha.
But in the second part of this episode, she shares something with us that she said she has never shared live, and we were the first place that she shared this piece of information.
Wow. Okay. I don't even know what this is.
Yeah. We're going to tell you the stat of the day at the beginning of this episode and also at the beginning of the next episode, because I reveal the stat of the day in the second part of the episode. But producer, I have a statistic of the day.
Oh, do you?
I do.
It's the stat of the day. Ooh. It's the stat of the day.
In 2018, Pornhub reported that 6% of their users were female. What is that number today?
Oh. All right. Well, listener, let's you got to guess.
Think about how big porn is and how during COVID actually porn consumption went up tenfold.
Obviously, she's telling us it went up.
It totally did. We've said this in previous. We've said this in previous episodes that consumption of porn and dating sites and OnlyFans. I mean, we know that people fucked and during lockdown.
Yeah, like multiple partners too.
Right. That increased as well. So, in 2018, Pornhub reported 6% of their users as female, identifying as female. What is that number today?
Well, the funny way to do it would be like 6.9%, obviously. But I'm going to really play today so I can play against the listener and see if they can do it.
I will tell you, Jessica and Kevin both were close.
Oh, I bet they were. You were watching too, weren't you? That's called edging, Ashley. I've learned a lot from this podcast. I'll go. So wait, it's not how much it's increased. It's what it is right now.
What is the number today?
I'll go 25%.
Okay, 25%.
That's still pretty big, but like kind of low.
Yeah, and when we do the intro for the second episode,
I'm getting poker face. I'm getting nothing from you.
Nope, nothing. When I do the intro for the second episode, I actually, you know what? You're gonna have to listen to the episode to find out.
You. Oh.
I'm not telling you. You're gonna have to listen to the episode to find out the percentage, like everybody else.
Right.
Yeah. I was going to tell you at the beginning of the next episode, but I'm not going to tell you. I'm going to wait until the episode.
Even I'm confused, listener. Okay, sorry. You got it, Ashley.
So, before we get into the episode, I just want to thank Jessica Drake and thank her for her time, her friendship, and just for being a kind human being. The listener's probably pissed, but there's no video of this, so...
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm busy.
We wouldn't have had a video anyways because we did this episode at a bar. So just for everyone listening, True. If the sound is a little funky, it's because we recorded this at a bar in the Orange Circle because Jessica had driven up from LA to do my presentation for my class. And I wanted to make it as easy as possible on her. Stay in Orange. We went to one of my favorite bars, unofficial sponsor, 1886. They were so fucking accommodating and said we could come back anytime. It's right by my school.
Yeah.
They said we can come back anytime we want to do an episode.
Great.
And Jessica had French fries and was very happy. And
they have good food there.
They have great food there. And so thank you, 1886, for your hospitality. And thank you, Jessica, for your time. Listener, here is part one.
Well, I want to give you a thank you.
Oh.
Big girl Ashley did it all by herself.
Not all by myself. Husband Kevin Weller was a fucking champion. I
wasn't there. That's what I'm just saying. Is I was
Robert Main was not there. He has been working tirelessly on a show for 21 straight days, and there was nothing he could have done.
Day 10 right now.
To get out of this, and we weren't going to move Jessica, and he couldn't move work, and so we made it work. And husband Kevin Weller just... Big
you didn't
fat
tell,
props.
Before, you didn't tell me. And then when I saw like the photo that he was there, I was like, oh, I felt a little more relieved.
Absolutely.
He's pretty
tech savvy. He took over the computer. He took over that he wore the headphones. He told us if we sounded good. He asked good. He gave input at perfect times. He was the perfect stand-in. And we love him dearly. So shout
intern.
Out.
Good intern.
Great intern. Shout out to husband Kevin Weller for his help. I did not do it by myself. I will not take that credit. But I did...
you're still a big girl.
I'm just a big girl. I wore my big girl pants and I did the podcast and it didn't get deleted and I didn't fuck it up. Yay. And we got Jessica Drake. So I really, really hope that everybody loves this episode. Remember, it's a two-parter. Two parts. We'll be back for the outro in just a bit. But enjoy the first hour and a half with the one, the only, the sexy as fuck, Jessica Drake. Ever waddle to the bathroom after sex, towel between your legs, desperately trying to keep the freshly delivered load from dripping down your leg and onto your hardwood? Well, worry no more. Awkward Essentials introduces the Drip Stick, or as I like to call it, the Cum Sponge. This medical-grade sponge sucks up jizz before it sneaks onto your sheets. Visit awkwardessentials.com today and use my code WYP for a 10% discount. They offer numerous products for all types of fun fluids. Keep your shorts semen-free and use my code today. That's WYP and save 10%. Awkward Essentials, making bodily fluids less awkward. Welcome, fellow humans, to our episode of What's Your Position podcast, where we are joined by the one, the only, 26-time award-winning Best Actress, 11 AVNs, Best Performer of the Year, Certified Sex Educator, porn star extraordinaire, and all-around amazing fucking human being, Jessica motherfucking Drake.
Hi! What do I even say after that amazing intro? Clearly someone did their research.
I did. I have been wanting to have you come on my podcast for probably 9 months. I think you spoke at a human sexuality class I teach, and scheduling wasn't working out. It was still COVID, icky, dumb, stupid shit. And I am just more than grateful for your presence today on the show, and for you I can't thank you enough.
I'm so happy to be here, and I'm really glad that it worked out. And you made me blush with that intro, and that's something that not very many people have been able to do. So congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Get the award for making Jessica Drake blush.
I made Jessica Drake blush. So I wanted you on the show for a few reasons. One, because it's really been important to me to have somebody who works in the sex industry come on and talk about what it's like to be a champion for sex work is work. That's a hashtag I use regularly. I post a lot of content on my page about sex work and how appreciative I am of the human beings in that job, in that realm, because I utilize individual. We just went to the strip club. Husband Kevin Weller is here, everybody, by the way. He's standing in for producer Robert Main. Husband, say hello.
Hey, what's up, everybody?
We just went to the strip club on Friday night. It's one of the things that we love to do together. I love going to see strippers dance.
Me too.
Well, ma'am, you just revealed something to me. You still dance.
Yeah, I do. Yeah.
I am like blown away that was like one of your beginnings. Like that was like one of the things you did to start your career.
I mean, it's probably when you look at the bigger picture, it is probably how I got my start. I was an underage stripper back in the day. But then eventually I was doing it through high school. I went to college eventually, and I was working in a strip club when I met people who were involved in the adult industry.
Yeah.
And they were like, hey, you should, this was in Texas where I'm from, and they were like, hey, you should come out to California and do porn. And I'm like, nope, not for me. Could never do that. And well, fast forward, and here we are right now. So yeah, strip clubs are very pivotal to my story, for sure.
How many years did you dance before you had your, and I just coined this, by the way, not your aha moment, but your oh yeah moment, where you realized you were going to go from dancing to porn. When was that moment for you?
Oh, well, it actually didn't really just happen like that. I don't think that it ever was a moment. It was yeah. It was more like a what moment, because I was fielding all of these offers from people who wanted me to do magazines and offer roles in movies and things like that. And I was like, yeah, I don't really think that's for
me. They
were
offering this to you at the strip club?
While I was still living in Texas, still dancing in Texas, I met a great group of people that were from LA who were in the adult industry. I didn't know it then, but it was a pretty famous director, his wife, his crew, his camera people,
wow,
his makeup artist, his lighting guys. They were all there shooting something. I didn't know that then. But we got into a conversation.
Was it Debbie Does Dallas?
No. It was in El Paso. It was about to be Jessica Does El Paso, but
Jessica Does El Paso.
Was it Wicked?
No, not at all. It was definitely pre-Wicked and still a great group of people, and I just didn't think I was ready. I didn't think that was a step I was wanting to take, not because I didn't, I had no misconceptions about the industry before I got into it, but I just didn't think it was something that I was going to do. I was very comfortable being naked on a stage, and had been all over the place for a really long time. But I was like, nah, I don't. It's not for me. Surprise. It was for me.
It's for you.
It's for me.
Knock, knock. It's for you.
And eventually what ended up happening was they invited me out here, and I was like, by this time they had gotten to be pretty close friends of mine. So I came out to visit them, and they jokingly offered me a part. So they had offered me a part in probably a dozen movies. One day they jokingly said, hey, we have this shoot coming up. Do you want to do it? I was like, yeah. And they thought I was kidding. And I, you know, we were like, are you serious? I'm serious. Are you serious? I'm serious. Are you serious? So I actually shot a boy-girl sex scene before a girl-girl sex scene, because that's not really the way things normally work. Like, maybe a girl will get in and do like a solo scene and then a girl-girl scene and then a boy-girl scene. No.
There's a linear process to how porn normally works?
I mean, I think there used to be more than there is now.
So in porn, it's a solo scene.
Usually, when a girl doesn't know for sure if she wants to get into the business, it's easier just to do a solo scene, just to kind of test out the waters.
And your first scene?
Boy-girl.
Boy-girl.
Yeah. Boy-girl. In a house in Malibu, in a bedroom downstairs with the sliders open to the beach. So, the waves are crashing. I can smell salt water. I'm on these, crisp white sheets.
You had a fantasy for a first porn?
But I really did.
Oh.
But beforehand, everybody was like, are you okay? Are you all right? Are you nervous? Or, do you need anything? Or are you okay? I'm like, I'm fine.
Do you remember the scene?
Of course.
Do you remember the guy?
Yes, of course.
Everything was good and you...
Well, we were friends first. He was part of the group of people that I had met initially, so I knew him. So it wasn't like I was having sex with a stranger. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but there was some familiarity there, and I, trusted him, and the director trusted him to sort of help me through my first scene, because, sometimes when people are new, they need a little guidance, but I didn't, apparently, because we started out, and all I remember is as soon as they were all set up and ready and took photos before the scene, those are pretty girl photos, that's what they call them, and then we started the scene, and we never really stopped. I mean, we just had sex all the way through, and then at the end, we were done, and the director was like,
cut?
Surely you've done that before. And I was like, have sex? Yeah, of course. duh, I have sex. But they were just blown away. They were like, you weren't the least bit uncomfortable. I'm like, no, I've been on a stage with bright lights on me for some years now.
To be fair, being a dancer, being on a stage where no one really touches, they touch you, but it's not.
I mean, it was El Paso, though.
Okay,
so
fair. But it's got to be a little bit jarring to have it be about you enjoying sex rather than you. I feel like dancing, was that ever for you? Is it?
I love dancing. Love it. Love it.
Oh,
so I'm all right.
I just learned this on the way over here. she does residency. So, like, a strip club in New York called her agent, and said, can Jessica come and dance at this night that we have coming up? And they pay for her to fly out there and stay out there. And then she is, like, the guest star of the show.
Yeah, yeah.
And dances. How long do you dance for?
You mean, like, how long am I on stage? I do one show. No, I do one show. So the requirement is only 12 to 15 minutes for a show. So it's one night, one show only, do a meet and greet. I can do VIPs if I want. I want. But it's so... I enjoy it, and I enjoy the interaction, especially now that we're moving past the pandemic or through the pandemic.
Yes.
The interaction is something that people have been so starved for that I am so eager to just make contact with everyone and just make them happy again, that I generally stay on stage for between 25 and 35 minutes.
Wow.
And I have absolutely had DJs be like,
get off,
wrap it up,
stay.
Only because they want me in the VIP rooms.
Yeah.
And I'm happy to be on stage, and I give away free stuff. Like, I have fleshlights. I give away fleshlights. I give away lube. Like, I do so many free giveaways. So I love being up there. You know, I crowd surf. I bring people up and make out with them and everything. Like,
it's
amazing.
God.
But then at some point, I have to get back to work.
Could you imagine going to a strip club and Jessica Drake is there and she brings you up on stage and makes out with you? Like, that would blow human beings' minds.
It does not suck.
It does not suck. The biggest reason I wanted you on this podcast wasn't just to talk about sex positivity and being positive about sex workers, but it's because one of your mottos is that you want to help people have the best sex of their lives.
Yeah, whatever that looks like for them.
Whatever that looks like for them. And I think that is one of the most beautiful and, like, sincere forms of not only artistry, like, you know what you're good at. You're an artist, and you're using your medium, you're using your art to better the lives of human beings. And I find that to be one of the most beautiful and humbling things any person could be part of. And I am just in awe of how much you do, not only for the community of sex, but for the community of LA, for individuals who maybe don't have a lot in the world, whether that be a lot of orgasms, or whether that be a lot of knowledge about their bodies, or whether that be food on their table. We're gonna get into your favorite charity in a little while, but first, I want you to talk to me about Jessica Drake's Wicked Guide to Sex.
Oh.
Please.
Okay.
Educate the listener about what this is, where they can find it, and why they should use it.
Okay, so thank you for all of those kind words, too. It kind of speaks to my desire to use my powers for good, because I realize that I'm really lucky. Like, where I come from and where I am today are two very different places. So I always said that as I developed and grew and accomplished, that I would always remember where I came from and how lucky I am, which is why I am apt to go back to El Paso from time to time and visit all the places I used to be and the places I used to, I can't even say live, I'll say the places that I stayed. And the
places
strip,
you existed.
Yeah, the strip clubs that I grew up in, if I could say that, you know, but I'm really, like, I'm lucky. I'm so lucky I have it tattooed on me. Like, I'm lucky.
Oh,
like, I remind myself of that all the time. So I decided that I'm so lucky. I just want to use my powers for good. One of the ways that I do that is sort of balancing what people see on screen as that fantasy performer that's capable of double penetration. And
you can
I had to look around.
You can say double penetration and it's fine.
Except...
I know.
Okay.
I see it.
All right.
I see it.
So we'll just say DP, like Dr. Pepper, but way different.
Way,
But like, I can be that person, and I can, but there's a lot more to that, right? Like, I can be that fantasy person, a performer that does all the things, that loves group sex, but there's also a lot of other facets, like a completely different component of myself that the people that are just there for the fantasy, they rarely get a glimpse of. But it was one of the things that made me change my trajectory towards sex education. I would have people come up to me and go, hey, there's something wrong with us. We can't do it the way you do it. And it would always be about like squirting or anal sex or something like that. And it took me a long time to realize that they only thought they couldn't do it. They just didn't understand how it was done.
It's not that they couldn't do it. It's that no one
right.
has ever said, hey, if you would like to squirt, this is how you can go about doing that.
Right.
Or anal sex has different steps than vaginal penetration. There's different levels and layers to it. And your website had how many videos? 9?
14.
Okay, I can't count.
That's okay.
I
have a guide to weekend sex counting.
I watched the anal mm-hmm. guide to wicked sex.
Yep.
I really want to watch the squirting one.
Yep.
We are going to talk about your thoughts on squirting, but what response have you gotten from people about your videos and how they've helped them in their relationships or just within themselves?
Yeah, so right before I started doing the guides, before I started directing and producing and doing all the creating, I started doing workshops for people. And when I would do workshops, I would take it very seriously and deal with people on a very individual basis. Mm. And what I mean by that is if someone was asking me for information, they weren't just getting the information, they were also getting some type of follow-up. So whether it was an email or I gave them a way to get a hold of me or website or something, I had people telling me, one person in particular who had been married for a really long time, who had been faking orgasms for her entire marriage, didn't know how to tell her partner she wasn't really coming, had never experienced an orgasm, not even by herself.
Oh.
She was eventually able to have some orgasms, and the impact that I made on her life, she said, was immeasurable, right? Yes. And that stopped me in my tracks and went, you know, I like to help people,
yep.
but like that took it to another level. So at that point, I considered the guides very seriously, and I went to Wicked, I went to the powers that be, and I was like, so here's what I want to do. And I pitched it, and the owner said, do one guide and we'll see how it does. We'll see how they receive it. Because at the time I wasn't a certified sex educator.
Right.
I was a performer with a lot of knowledge.
Right. And so, experience.
Of course. So fellatio was the first one. And I shot it all in one day.
No.
And it was so hard to shoot an entire educational, I can't even tell you, in one day though. But
wait,
I did
so
it.
So you did the beginnings, like
the narration, the interviews, all of it
God.
In one day. Now, I'm not saying it was an early day. I think we wrapped at like 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, but it was all in one day. And so we edited it, we got it ready, we released it, it got great reviews, it sold really well. Then I got to do the rest of them.
And then you developed a line of lubrication with Wicked as well.
So it's not my line. It's actually what happened. What had happened
so what
was
happened?
We were considering branching out into the pleasure products industry because, as you know...
You say Wicked, you mean you.
Wicked. Wicked in general, like all of us had talked about it. And our industry was decimated by piracy, just completely taken out by piracy. And so we started to consider that you cannot pirate pleasure products. I mean, you can knock them off, really, if you, whatever. But not the same way that you can steal movies, steal scenes, user-uploaded content, all of that. Like, you just can't, you cannot download a dildo, right? So,
this is fact.
One day, 3D printing, you know.
One day.
But we considered lingerie, we considered toys. And we decided to start a lube company, which was separate from Wicked entirely, called Wicked Sensual Care. And it's actually our 10th anniversary. Yeah, it will in August. 10 years for Wicked Sensual Care. Yep.
So it worked.
So it's working. And we are super, super proud of the things that we've accomplished, the latest being the Simply Collection, which is an entire line that's propylene glycol and glycerin free. And we just introduced flavors to the Simply line.
Okay, so I saw on your Instagram about flavored lubes and why, and you're a writer too. You write blogs, you write articles for magazines, yep. You write articles for online publications. You're a really, really good writer,
Thank you. I'm good editors too.
You were talking about what flavored lubes are good for. And I know my listeners, and I also know my students, absolutely have a hard time with condoms.
Sure.
Because they taste like
condoms. Yeah.
And I just discovered a new product that I am in love with called Laurels. Have you heard of them?
Yes, and I know the people at Laurels.
I'm excited about this.
They're fantastic. They have FDA approval even.
FDA approval. Do you know how amazing this is?
Yeah, but they're huge.
So one of the things that is one of the biggest cruxes in my education history is when I go and speak at a school and I'm talking to these students about how to prevent STIs and I talk about using condoms. Never fails, a girl walks up to me and says, but what if I don't have sex with someone who has a penis?
Yeah.
What sort of protection am I supposed to use? Where's my barrier method?
Yeah.
And I'm like, girl, if I fucking had an answer for you, I would be a millionaire because I don't know. And they aren't technically FDA approved for female to female sex, but they can be used during tribbing, mm-hmm. which can protect both people
yep.
from transmitting any STIs, which is amazing because you can use lube with them.
Yes.
They stick to your skin and like all of the pieces and all of the labia are like, you can feel everything. I'm in love.
You're
with
a fan
this
of them, clearly.
I'm in love with this product. I love them.
I told her about it.
He did. He found them and was like, you need to call them and talk or email them and see if you, and they're sending me like free pairs.
I'm sure. I'm so yeah, excited. I met them years ago when they were first starting and
the
I was like, that
blows my mind.
Brilliant.
But I feel
brilliant.
Your lube and their product are two things that need to make a baby.
You hear that, Laurels?
You hear this? Like the peach lube.
Sweet peach
lube on a like give me cunnilingus with the Laurels on and enjoy my peach, bitch. Like, go.
I think we have our soundbite for this episode.
I think the name of the episode is Enjoy My Peach, Bitch.
that's it.
Agreed. So now I know to send you sweet peach.
Please send me sweet peach. I'm so excited. But for you, being in the that was a question I was going to ask. Is there a way to say it that doesn't, like, if I say, your time as a porn actress, your time in the porn industry, is there a more appropriate term?
No, I do not care. I mean, when I did my bio for the presentation that I did earlier today, so here's the deal. I am not a super fan of writing my own bio. It's just, there's just something about it. Like, I say some nice things about myself, and I look back, and I'm like, wow, I did a lot of stuff. Like, how do I pick my top three things or whatever? And I just don't like
talking
like
about
boasting about all the stuff that I, whatever. And so I decided to change like acclaimed adult actress or porn performer. I just put mattress actress.
Yeah, mattress actress.
When I started to do it, I started to put it everywhere. So I put it in my Instagram bio. I think it was on my Twitter. It might not be now, but like it's on my IG bio. It is literally, I gave a presentation at the Woodhull Sexual Freedom Summit, which that's a bit like
that's
cerebral. Like those are some thinking people.
Those are the people who come up with the technology for us to be able to make dildos in a factory.
And they defend our rights for sexual freedom, and yeah. I put mattress actress in my bio.
Bravo.
And I just say it like, what? Like, mattress actress. Like,
you were in the porn industry since 2000 and...
2000. We'll say about 2000.
2000? Yeah. Okay. And you just ended your Wicked contract. Is that correct?
Kind of correct. Kind of not correct. And this will be the first time I ever go on record and say what happened.
Oh.
So Wicked was sold to another company. Oh. They were lovely enough to contract me for a year. Kind of as a like a transitional period. Because, I mean, I was with Wicked forever.
Yeah.
You know, I was like...
Almost 20 years,
I
right?
was like the face of Wicked.
Yeah.
And, of course, I gave them... all of my firsts sexually, like I gave them, like basically everything
well,
in my
career. Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Were you the first porn actress to do a multiple trans
yes.
scene?
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Do you want to know who told me that fact?
Who?
That man right there. Yeah. Yeah. He was like sending me facts today. He's like, did you know that Jessica Drake was the first actress to have a scene with multiple trans women? And
before,
I was like, what?
Before it was cool.
Yeah.
And the reason that I started working with trans performers on camera is because I was already having sex with people who are trans in my personal life. Mm-hmm. And I got to a point in my career where I just decided that it was more important to me to portray authenticity than it was to do scenes that people expected me to do. And
yeah.
also it was a bit of a fuck you to the people who thought, oh, well, that's not okay. Like, no crossover performers. Like, that's not okay. So I
also,
just decided
it takes the
to...
stigma out of it, too. When you go and you see... And I hate the way that they're... That's another thing that I really can't stand is when I see your name on something and, like, it says... Jessica Drake with a she-male. I'm like, Jessica Drake would not fucking
never,
approve that title.
Never.
Like, get that out of here. But like, for you to be the face of Wicked, which is like the biggest porn production company, to be a Wicked girl, to win AVN awards for them, and to cross that boundary and to cross over and bring those actresses with you,
and it had to be done. It was a long, it was long past time though, and that was like 5-6 years ago.
Yeah, it wasn't even that long.
That I did the first scene, and then I just kept doing them like the rest of the time that I was there. But when Wicked was sold, it was like right before the pandemic, and I wasn't comfortable shooting. No one was really shooting at that time, so. I would do these daily vlogs for Wicked.com. Mm. It would be like a minute with JD, whatever. And it would be like me out in the middle of nowhere with a COVID mask on with like cops trying to get me to get in the car and not be out in public. Like it was just bizarre. It was depressing and bizarre. But I tried to do some type of content. I did solo live shows for a while. And then when it was time to start shooting again, honestly, they weren't willing to shoot me with condoms.
What?
And no, and this is the first time I've ever
well,
gone on...
Wicked was the first...
Well, Wicked was the only company that was condom only. Condom only, right. And so with the sale, they said, hey, are you... And we talked a lot about it. They were like, are you okay being condom optional? And I'm like, hey, I love the idea of giving everyone a choice if it's truly a choice. If you hire a performer and they want to use a condom, you don't give them a hard time. Because as a director, I encourage whatever type of safer sex practices someone wants to engage in. So I made a whole career when people told me I couldn't. I made a whole career off of only working with condoms.
Yeah.
And then the company was sold. And then I was contracted for a year with the new company. And then when I was ready to shoot... They were like, we'll never shoot you with condoms. There's no way. And so...
Are you fucking serious?
Instead of making a massive deal out of it, I was like, maybe this is life just moving me in different directions. It was very mutual. They did not renew. I did not attempt renewal. So it's heartbreaking in a way because I was such a part of...
You made Wicked.
You made
and
Wicked what they were.
And Wicked made me.
Right.
So it was very mutual, but the budgets are not the same anymore. The directors are not the same. The performers are not the same anymore. And I'm not saying they don't have anyone over there. They do. They have a few people that I'm really fond of. But it is not where I came from anymore. So.
I think that porn, I was going to talk about this with you and then we're going to take a quick break. But I always teach my students, porn is always ahead of its time when it comes to media. When it comes to the medium that people view pornography, porn is at the forefront.
Yep.
Porn used to be on walls in Rome. We went to, where the fuck did we go? Pompeii. And we went into the old ruins of the volcano village, and there's dicks everywhere.
They're of course.
Everywhere.
I mean.
And I mean, there's statues before there was magazines, and then there was still photographs, and then there was, you know, the little viewfinder that you could look at with porn, and there was 15-second porn, and then there was magazines, and then there was porn movie houses, and porn has been at the forefront of technology, but I think, and I want to see if you agree with me on this or not, I think the internet killed porn.
Yeah, absolutely. No, well, I wouldn't say that the internet killed porn. I would say the internet killed the porn industry as it was. Ugh. Because now when we have platforms where content creators are their own bosses, I think that has empowered performers that otherwise never would have had a voice in this conversation. And bigger companies hate that because now they can no longer get talent to show up and say, we can't pay you your rate. We can only give you half of your rate. Because that talent is like, you know what? My OnlyFans will pay me whatever I want. Absolutely. Yeah, any of those platforms. Me specifically, I'm on OnlyFans, but like, I mean, it has put so much power and control into our hands. And during the pandemic, when I wasn't shooting for anyone but myself, it was lonely, but also I was like, I have to do something for people. I have to have a purpose or I'm not going to live through this. So I would get locations during the pandemic and it would just be me, no makeup. I mean, makeup, yes, but like no makeup artist, no hairstylist, no lighting person, no camera person, no sound person. I was a one-person show. I had every piece of equipment and I learned how to use it. And I would just be at a location all day by myself, listening to music and creating content for people. And I did that enough and I got so good. I mean, sorry, like I'm going to brag a minute, I got so good at it that I got to a point where I was like, why am I going to jeopardize a belief system that I've had for 20 plus years to shoot for a company that doesn't give two shits about me anymore?
Yeah.
Wicked
for your safety.
Wicked used to take care of me. Like, I felt like as a contract performer, a contract director, they always took care of all of their people. So to have that conversation with not even the owner of the company, because that would have been better if he would have been like, hey, you know, we just can't do this anymore. What do you think about this? But no, they had somebody do it for them.
Wow.
To give me the we're never going to shoot. We're never going to shoot you with condom speech. And I was like, you know what? Cool.
And it's a dangerous conversation to have because you see the success of male and female actors on OnlyFans.
Yeah.
And then you see what they're making.
Yeah.
And they're like, well, why wouldn't I just go and work for myself?
Right.
Do what I want.
Yeah.
Do what I want.
Yeah.
The scenes that I want.
Do you still get to shoot with, like, do you get to have, I would think that as a mattress actress, part of the joy in that is the different people you get to fuck.
Yeah.
Like, you get to fuck a trans woman. You get to fuck a lesbian woman. You get to fuck a 6'9", 280-pound Samoan man. Because you work in the porn industry and you got to do these scenes, do you still feel like you get to have sex with enough people?
Well, no, because... So everything that I have shot to date has been solo.
Wow.
Now, I get really creative. I bring every suction cup dildo I have, and it's on every surface of everything. It's like a COVID-safe gangbang, if you will.
You just walk around the room.
I mean, basically, yeah. And I mean, I've had some really funny outtakes too, but usually I don't let those out.
You should create fan content that's just bloopers.
Outtakes.
People would buy it.
I'm sure. But I'm at the point right now where I'm really starting to consider what shooting with other people is going to look like for me, because I've always been really picky and I've always had my favorites. So recently, I had a really hard time, like everyone. I had a really hard time during the pandemic for a lot of reasons. I had a 16-year relationship. My partner broke up with me.
During COVID?
Yep, at the very beginning of COVID. I had my ex-husband, who I was very, very close to. He died at the beginning of COVID.
Jesus.
He died 7 days before lockdown. And we were really close. Like, I had crisis after crisis during this, like many people did, during this pandemic. And I'm only just now starting to maybe reimagine what everything looks like moving forward. But I can tell you that everything that I've shot lately for my OnlyFans, like, I devote massive shoot days, beautiful locations, wardrobe, makeup. It's all very stylized. I'm using people to help me. I'm using a crew again. And I'm really ready to get back to gangbangs.
Okay. On that note, we're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, I'm going to ask Jessica some questions that I have personally had for the last 9 months. Join us in a second.
What's Your Position podcast wants to hear from you. Call 513-6969-SEX anytime and leave us a message. Maybe you have a question about anal, you have a fact about fisting, or you just want to say, hello, fellow human. 513-6969-SEX. Call us. We will play your message in an upcoming episode. That's 513-6969-739. And remember, stay safe, stay kind, and stay sexy. Welcome back, fellow humans. Hope you enjoyed that first little taste of Jessica Drake, phrasing, and that you learned some interesting facts about her, her empire that she's built for herself, what she's been doing in her time off during COVID. We discussed ethical pornography, what it means, where you can find it. She had some great ideas. Pink and White is a website that she loves. Jizzle, I don't think I'm saying it right. J-I-Z-Z-L-E. Jizzle, I guess, is another one that she really likes. And we wanted to go ahead and plug her charity as well. Feed the Streets_LA. So there's Feed the Streets LA and there's Feed the Streets New York. And she started this during COVID. She just started to go out into her community and give food and toiletries to people who were living in Skid Row, and she started seeing the same people week after week who were doing the same thing. And so they formed a charity, and they became a charity all by themselves, just feeding people. And she says every single Sunday she goes to a specific street in Hollywood and she gives out trays of food, hot food, coffee, donuts, blankets, clothing, toiletries, and you can donate. Go to feedthestreets_LA on Instagram is where you can find out all of their information. And mainly Jessica Drake's Instagram. I follow her on Instagram. By the way, she followed me back and she followed husband Kevin Weller. And I have talked to her in our stories and she talks back to me. So we're like best friends. We're clearly best friends now. You may have also heard me
follow Ram Martin Media.
Maybe. Yeah, we should. Once I started the podcast, I realized how much of a fangirl I was going to be. So I really hope that I don't sound too obsessed, but she's
prolific in pornography. She's a prolific porn star. And, you know, I was so proud of Kevin for not like fangying, I guess. He asked really great questions and was just, she's just so down to earth. She makes you feel real comfortable.
Oh, he's on?
Yeah, he talked.
Oh, he
yeah.
talked.
Yeah, he talked. Oh, yeah, he okay. like added a couple things here and there.
He's in it for my job now. I see how it is. I see how it is.
He's coming for you.
I see you, Weller. He's downstairs. He can hear me.
He can hear. But yeah, this first part is perfect to end with. And we will be releasing the second part soon. So please make sure you check us out on Instagram for updates. We will also be discussing some giveaways. So stay tuned for that. Some Jessica Drake themed giveaways as well. Check out our sponsors. Four Sons Brewing. They have three locations in Huntington Beach. They're fucking phenomenal. They have a Fuck Cancer beer out right now, which is really amazing.
I saw that. Yeah.
In correlation with Fuck Cancer. And then also Laurels. These are FDA approved STI protective latex based underwear. You can get a 4-pack from mylaurels.com.
Where is it?
And use my... Oh yeah, let me show you.
Real quick. We'll do a...
I haven't taken them out yet because I want to take them
out.
Oh,
yeah. We're going to do an official one.
This is what they look like when they come to you. This tiny, cute little package. And they're right inside. Use them during your period. Use them for rimming. Use them for kink. Use them if somebody has stubble. Use them for tribbing. Use them for anything your heart desires, really. And use my code for a discount. What's Your Position Podcast? All one word. Get that discount. Let Laurels know that you heard it here.
Help us out. We get a little,
and help us. We get a little piece. We get a little kickback. Get a little kickback. Thank you so much for tuning into this first half. I hope it entices you to listen to the second half. Remember, as always, stay safe, stay kind, stay sexy. What's Your Position Podcast represents the opinions of Ashley Weller and her guests. The content here should not be taken as medical advice and is intended for education and entertainment purposes only. Views and opinions expressed in the podcast are our own and do not represent that of our places of work. While we make every effort to ensure the information we are sharing is accurate, we welcome any comments, suggestions, or correction of error. Stay safe, stay kind, and stay sexy.